Hello everyone, welcome back to the Science Hub. Michelle Teju,
Michelle Gavani,
and Tiffany McKenna.
Today we'll be talking about the differences between aerobic and anaerobic respiration. Michelle, you take it from there.
So first, in aerobic respiration, oxygen is necessary for this process to take place, while in anaerobic respiration, oxygen is not required because the substrates are not completely broken down. The second point is high amounts of energy are released, that is 38 ATP, while in anaerobic, low amounts of energy are released, that is 2 ATP. The third one is substrate is not completely broken down to water and carbon 4 oxide in aerobic, while in anaerobic, substrate is not completely broken down. As a result, lactic acid or alcohol is produced. The fourth one is in aerobic respiration, the end products are water and carbon 4 oxide, while in anaerobic respiration, the end products are alcohol in plants and lactic acid in animals. The fifth one is, in aerobic respiration, water molecules are produced, while in anaerobic respiration, water molecules are not produced. The sixth one is energy is released over a short period in aerobic respiration, while in anaerobic, energy is released faster over a short period. I'll now let it take it to Tetu to explain the application of aerobic respiration in industry and at home. The first point is commercial production of alcohol with yeast to produce beer. The second point is in dairy industries to produce milk production. For example, milk contains lactic acid. This lactic acid is anaerobically broken down into milk sugar. This milk sugar also contains the lactic acid, which is known as the lactose. The end products of these are cheese, butter, and yogurt. My third point is sewage treatment plants from home and industries. Most of the raw sewage from home and industries is directed to the sewage treatment plants. These sewage treatment plants, they release or introduce a bacteria that is, they introduce a bacteria to the sewage that breaks it down. That breaks the sewage down to aerobic respiration. My fourth point is in agriculture, making a silo. We know a silo, it contains grass, kitchen refuse, compost manure, and all those. The grass that is contained inside the silo, it contains some sugar. And then the bacteria that will be introduced in the grass uses the sugar that is contained in the grass for fermentation. And to my fifth point, it is production of biogas. Production of biogas, manure and cows and other animals produce waste products. These waste products are used as biogas. As we know, the biogas contains 70% of naphthalene. This naphthalene is used for cooking or for producing light. My sixth point, in homes, baking, baking of breads and baking of donuts. As we know, we use the yeast to ferment and make the breads and donuts. I leave my colleague Tiffany to continue on their respiratory substrates.
Energy rich in food substrates, which when oxidized release energy. This, for example, we have carbohydrates, protein, and fats. Carbohydrates are the main source of energy in respiration, that is glucose, fructose, and galactose. In plants, they synthesize their own food substances, that is cellulose, starch, and sugars. While animals, they get their food from plants, they feed on plants to get food. That's so they produce maize, cassava, and rice. Then fats produce more energy than proteins and starch. Then plants synthesize fats and oils to produce certain plants, such as like groundnuts, sunflower, etc. While animals rich in fat include ghee, butter, milk, and cheese. While Fat cannot be used as the main substrate. This is because it's insoluble and it requires more energy than protein and starch. Then proteins are further broken down into amino acids. I'll then pass it on to my colleague, Michelle Tate, to respiratory content and its significance.
Respiratory content and its significance. This is the ratio between This shows the relationship between the carbon 4 oxide that has been produced against the oxygen that has been used during respiration. Okay, in order to calculate this respiration quotient, we use this formula. Volume This is the formula that we use. This is the volume of the CO2 divided by the volume of the oxygen. So for example, if you're given a question, this is a question, example. Can I grab it and set it up? So if you're given this question, we use the formula that you were given, that I had shown you before. So this is our carbon 4 oxide over the oxygen. This is our oxygen that was produced. So the number of our carbon 4 oxide is, the question is 6. So you take the 6, divide it by the oxygen that was produced, that is the 6. When you divide them, your respiratory quotient will be 1. And in substrate, 1 is represented by carbohydrate. So this is a carbohydrate. I leave it on to my colleague, Tiffany, to take it further.
We'll go on to example two. Okay, we'll use the example that you were given earlier on. The respiratory content equals to volume of carbon dioxide over volume of oxygen. So this will be our oxygen and this will be our carbon dioxide. Then we divide this. When we divide it, we'll get 0.7, and 0.7 is our fat substrate. Now we'll go on, I'll pass it on to my colleague Michelle to explain. Michelle Gaffani to explain the factors affecting the rate of respiration.
These are temperature, body size, level of activity, and growth.
We have come to the end of our discussion today on Science Hub. I have been Tiffany McKenna,
Michelle Tetu,
Michelle Gaffani.
Keep it Elimu TV, where we watch
and learn.